Hola, buenos dias, como esta? This is Kai Pacha with the weekly Pele Report. And today is Wednesday, September 24th of 2014. So much to say in so little time. Oh my God, I don't have time to head out into the wilderness today. I'm so sorry. I gotta stand in front of some flowers here in the yard. And go into, you know, some big things. We just had the equinox. Sun has moved into the sign of Libra. Next Monday, Venus moves into the sign of Libra. This weekend, Mercury moves out of the sign of Libra into the sign of Scorpio. And Saturn is in Scorpio. And then Friday, this new moon goes through Libra. Wednesday, Thursday, Friday goes into Scorpio. Goes through Scorpio, hits Saturn over the weekend, and then on Sunday, goes into Sagittarius. Monday, I think she hits Mars and moves on into Capricorn by, you know, Tuesday or Wednesday, yeah? And I'll talk about that first quarter moon later, but I want to be talking more about this very interesting situation that's going on here. It's a little more long term. I want to give you this big picture because we're talking now about Libra and Scorpio. And these are the two signs most to do with personal relationships, one-on-one relationships, partnerships, cooperating, compromising, merging, uniting, building, you know, doing things that we can't do alone. Yeah? And this is a very powerful time of transformation that goes over a long period of time. Because let's look at it. It was in September of 2012 that the North Node of the Moon, which moves clockwise backwards through the zodiac, went into Scorpio and stayed there until February of 14, where she went into the sign of Libra, where she is now, and she's going to stay there, yeah, until November of 2015. This is the North Node of the Moon, spending 3 years in Scorpio and Libra. The North Node of the Moon is our future evolution of our soul. And in this case, it's the collective soul consciousness. The collective consciousness of humanity will evolve and further itself through moving into the unknown, the unfamiliar realm of the other, Scorpio Libra. Particularly for these 3 years of the September of 12 until November of 15. With the South Node of the Moon, having moved through Taurus, is now in Aries, conjunct the planet Uranus. And this is another interesting thing that's going on. Okay, is at the same time that these nodes are moving through Scorpio and Libra, is the same time that this Uranus, the first Uranus-Pluto square, was in June of 2012. And the last one, seven of them, is in March of 2015. So what we have here is it coincidence? Not. There is no coincidence in astrology. There's no accidents in astrology. There's things we can't explain. There's phenomena and events beyond our comprehension. But there's no accidents. So it is no accident that Uranus is square Pluto at the same time that the nodes are moving through Scorpio and Libra. In fact, coming up to square Pluto and South Node conjunct Uranus right now, this says that this huge evolutionary expansion of human consciousness, Uranus in Aries, breaking free and breaking out of old patriarchal external authorities, laws, domination, Illuminati control, religious conditioning, all that old crap going down the pipeline. Pluto moving through Capricorn has to make way for this new Uranus in Aries, which is a new self-consciousness to emerge. And it's happening by letting go of the South Node, Aries Taurus. I, me, my, myself, my control, my desire, my way, my egocentric, narcissistic sense of self, and moving into relationship, partnership, cooperation, compromise, sacrifice, service, all the S words. Suicide? No, just kidding. Oh my God. Now even beyond that, let's also now look at the synodic cycle of Venus. Because last week, Venus went into the underworld. Yeah? She has been a morning star. Venus rising first thing in the morning, before the sun, since last January, February. And seven lunar cycles, yeah? Like the seven gates that Inanna descends to go into the underworld. And so when she's within 10 degrees of the sun, we can't see her. So last week she disappeared from the morning sky, and we're not going to see her until when? Oh my God, 60 days in the underworld around December 2nd. She's going to rise in the west. Yeah? And she will be an evening star. So we look at least I look at, you know, east and west. In the native indigenous people's traditions that I'm familiar with, I mean, it varies from tribe to tribe. This is different, okay? This is not like dogmatic law. But the east is very often associated with red, with fire, the element of fire, yeah, with the eagle, with power, self-direction. It's the warrior, yeah? It's in charge. It's nuclear power that brings change through radiation, illumination of light from my core, from my center, from myself out. Very masculine, very macho. Very I do, I desire, I want, I penetrate, I start, I pioneer. This is the East. Venus has been there in the East, a very powerful warrior goddess. And even in the story of Inanna, when Inanna descends into the underworld, she is a brazen, ballsy, youthful, like an adolescent, you know, adolescent goddess of love. And she says, I'm going down. Nobody's allowed in the underworld, but I'm going down into the underworld. I'm going to check it out. Too funny, man. So she goes down through the seven gates. And it's not quite what she thought. The first gate, she loses her crown. The second gate, she loses her jewelry and her necklaces, each of the seven chakras, until she's bare-ass naked in front of who? Arishkigal, the goddess of hell, which is actually her sister, who kills her, hangs her on a meat hook. She dies. She's dead, gone, absolutely surrendered. No willpower, no control, no force, no pushing, no ego, dead, annihilated, ego demolished, goodbye. And then she is, they had to come down and get her and ask Arishkigal to release her and let her up and take her off that meat hook. And then she rose as the result of the intervention of others. A very important key part of that mythology, of that story. Then she arises not as the goddess of love, but as the queen of heaven. She has matured. She has grown. Very indicative of now of Saturn moving through Scorpio. Yeah, for its final days. And Saturn leaves Scorpio and goes into Sagittarius in December as Venus rises in the west out of the underworld also in December. So we have this time period now. Venus is just moving into Libra. The sun is already there. She's slowly, slowly, gradually catching up to the sun. She's going to be conjunct that sun, invisible to the naked eye. Yeah, because they're too close together. You can't see a planet that close. You can't look at the sun. And, of course, in time for the eclipse, we have then a total lunar eclipse on these moon's nodes. That's what the eclipses are. The eclipses, you know, since 12 and now 13, 14 into 15, all the eclipse cycles are happening now in Libra Aries on the nodal axis. That's what an eclipse is. It's a full moon or a new moon on the nodal axis until finally, that's October 8th, is that total lunar eclipse. And then on October 23rd, we have a solar eclipse. It's not total, but it's not only a solar eclipse. Venus is at the same degree. I got to do a longer video on eclipses. I'm going to do that for the New Paradigm community, a longer exploration into these eclipses. They're fascinating. This is one of my new favorite topics now. But anyway, at 0 degrees of Scorpio, we're going to have a Sun-Moon-Venus conjunction, October 23rd. Whoa. So we have this time period now. It's about a month, you know, as the Sun and Venus move through Libra. And what is the West? Libra. Aries is the East. The self, the powerful me. The West, in many of the indigenous peoples, it's black. The color is black. The element is water. The animal is the bear that goes into hibernation. There's kind of a death, an inward chaos, dark dream time. The water element is chaos and this dissolving, yes, of my ego, of my self-consciousness, of my self-centeredness. So when Venus rises, yeah, and even while she's going through, you know, Libra and Scorpio, there is this emphasis on evolution, growth, expansion, occurring through the letting go, the death, the surrendering of my ego, myself. We could say the masculine. Yeah, the masculine is about structure, form, clarity, linear logic, goal-oriented, you know, just the facts, the statistics, the visible, the tangible, the right here and now, clarity, the light. Turn the light on. I want to see. And we have this feminine, the underworld of chaos, of the dark, of the feelings, of the emotions, non-linear, non-logical, non-rational. You can't explain it. This is the mystery. This is alchemy. This is what the shamans deal with and work with. This is how we transform and transmute ourselves. The seed must die that it is born again, is how they put it in the Bible, yeah? And that, you know, that really reminds me also then again of, you know, like St. Francis, you know. It is in the giving that we receive, it is in the pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Kind of from the temporary, temporal, earthly ego existence or consciousness, limited to this dualistic, polarized, third-dimensional reality. The way out or the way up is through sacrifice, through surrender, through allowing and accepting and releasing control. This involves vulnerability. An old teacher of mine, she's dead now, Dr. Braithwaite, she said, You must be vulnerable to walk and experience the mysteries of life. And it is the mystery of life that holds the essence, the spirit, and the keys to deep wisdom, compassion, and love. This is hard for me to put into words. I'm trying to explain the kind of intangible, the mystery of life here that we can experience now. And all I want to say is it comes through sacrifice. Two single people sacrifice their single lives to join together in union. And then they sacrifice their own intimacy to give birth to an offspring, a child. And the parents sacrifice their money and their time and their energy. It's like all birth, all creation, all evolution is the result of a sacrificing of what is now existing, tangible. It's like, you know, a bird in my hand or two in the bush. Going from the known and the familiar, what I can control and understand, into the unknown, the unfamiliar. My teacher, Jeffrey Wolf Green, talks about Uranus in the 12th house. It's in my chart. You will find yourself in the unknown. Yeah? That's just one aspect of Uranus in the 12th house. But in general, the water houses, the water signs, Cancer, Scorpio, and Pisces, deal with these mysteries of surrender, of annihilation, of self, of ego. It's kind of an initiation. And that initiation leads to an expansion of consciousness, that I become greater. I walk in the mysteries. And those mysteries eventually feed me. Yeah? That's the juice, the water of life. Life can't exist without water. The sun can burn us and make deserts and droughts. This is the east and the fire. Fire can burn, but we need the water. So this is a really powerful, important time. And I just want to encourage us to come out of our ivory towers or out of our positions of authority, power, and control and relinquish the throne. Pluto in Capricorn. To allow ourselves to be transformed, transmuted, altered through union, merging, osmosis, orgasm, intercourse. Yes, this vulnerability, this open surrender. The French call the orgasm la petite death. There has to be this kind of this out-breath, this letting go, this relaxing, completely relaxing of myself in the midst of, in the face of, up against another, that we experience that ecstasy. So what I'm saying is nirvana, samadhi, ecstasy, orgasm, these things happen through and in front of and in face of and in relationship to another. Particularly while the North Node is in Scorpio and Libra. And particularly as we are coming out of the age of Pisces, monasteries, ashrams, meditation, into myself, you know, separate myself into the, you know, away, the cave, the mountaintop, in order, you know, to experience the mysteries. That age is over. Now we're coming into Aquarius. It's group consciousness. It's the collective consciousness. It's community. It's other people. We're all in spaceship Earth together. So it's tripped out, huh? Yeah. Nobody gets there alone anymore. Yeah. You think you got your shit together until you get intimate. Anyway, the mantra for this week then is, when I do what I would not do because I'm in love with you, I leave my safe known self-centeredness and transform my soul through the mystery of love's process. You got that? That's a trippy one. You gotta kind of, this is a good one to kind of like meditate on for a little bit, you know? I mean, it kind of came to me slowly. It's kind of a, like, it takes a time to ripen. When I do what I would not do because I'm in love with you, I leave my safe, known self-centeredness and transform my soul through the mystery of love's process. I'm going to type it out, you know, I'm going to write it out underneath the video or something, you know, so you can read it and feel it. But that is what this time period is about. This merging and this union, Mercury joining Saturn in Scorpio, the Sun, new moon in Libra, Venus coming into Libra. You know, we're coming out of Aries through Virgo is subjective evolution of consciousness. Libra through Pisces is collective or relationship evolution of consciousness, transpersonal. So let's go there. Good luck. Have a good time. Let it all go. Namaste. Aloha. So much love.